Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. He rose from humble beginnings to one of the funniest comedians around.
Now he's taking his personal story, tragedy, and triumph on the road with a one-man show. Please welcome comedian Michael Collier.
Yes, Michael.
How are you?
Amazing.
And blessed.
Oh, hello, how are you?
Man, if I was doing any better, I think it was a setup.
Okay,
how y'all doing?
Have a seat.
See, look at you. You better wear them red shoes to pull in your tie.
Oh, and check out the socks. Do you see the socks?
We're going to see them. Bam!
Okay, yeah.
Now, with the feather in his cap and everything.
Right. Man, I knew I was going to be with beautiful women. I want to look good.
Oh, you're so sweet.
Well, you were successful. Yeah. Thank you for coming down.
Yes.
Now, listen, we know that you're on the road right now with the one man powerful show.
Yes.
It's tell me a little bit about
the
show.
It's funny, you keep almost saying one woman show.
I keep saying one woman show.
I don't have a problem with that because it is about one woman. It's about my mama.
About your mama.
It's called Mike Kaya's Mama.
Mike Kaya's Mama.
Yeah, if you like your mama, you're going to love this show. It's called Mike Kaya's Mama. And, you know, it's really a play, and I want people to understand that it's a play.
It's a play.
You know, a lot of people think when they see one man show, they think it's a long comedy show.
Correct.
No, it's a one man show. We'll talk about that a little later. It's fabulous.
Oh, absolutely. You
can imagine.
Around with us for a while.
Oh, we're y'all can't put me out now that I'm here.
Are you here?
Y'all got enough cameras too. Let me look at me.
Hey!
Yes, right? Too. You got it. You've been on TV before. You know that.
Yeah, once or twice.
Okay.
Let's talk a little bit about your beginnings in Venice Beach. You know, you were performing, as I understand,
for
on
9
the street.
Years. From 86 to 95. I stood out there and did 5 1-hour shows every Saturday and Sunday without missing, and had a fantastic time. Got to meet some of the greatest people, a lot of stars of the day who was just coming up, was coming out there watching me.
And
it was, in fact, we're going out to shoot it this summer as a 1-hour special called The King of Venice Beach. They built a stage that looks like a king's crown, and I stand right in the middle of it. It's going to be off the chain.
I am so proud you are getting your just due.
God bless you. Thank you. I'm overdue, girl.
Okay.
With some late fees on it.
I need to do some shopping.
Okay.
Hold my money like that.
I want to remind you something. Do you remember putting me on stage at your show at the Fitzgerald?
Absolutely.
In Vegas.
And you were hysterical.
And I'm still hysterical.
Yes,
thank you.
Absolutely hilarious.
Thank you.
The Fitzgerald was the only black-owned hotel that had a casino in Vegas.
Because
we don't really get them licenses.
At all.
Those gaming licenses.
Absolutely.
So it was historical, and you were hysterical. So it worked
out
great.
Thank you. So tell the people,
what
did
you grow?
Your
lips are fabulous.
Did
you do two things on it? Did you put like a base on it and then the gloss?
I did to these lips, honey, but my mama gave me the lips. Kelvin gave me the gloss.
Give your mama a high five. And thank Kelvin, too. I'm
okay.
Sorry.
So please tell me, where did you grow up?
Chicago, Southside, Projects, Rabatella Home, 4352 South State, apartment 909.
Now, you better know your address and your apartment number.
You better know your address.
Selena Johnson grew up in Chicago, too. Do you think that had a lot to do with your brand of comedy and who you are today?
Yes. I think your environment always determines what you're going to end up being, you know? And I grew up in the hood. I grew in a neighborhood where if the police caught you and you didn't have a pistol, they give you one.
Right.
So, it did affect.
And lacing the people up, framing the
that's
children.
That's right. Framing the children.
Ain't that nothing. So, we also understand that you won Star Search. Is that how you got discovered?
I haven't been discovered yet. Oh, no, they ain't discovered me. They still working on that. You know, and I done made a lot of money and had a lot of fun, but the discovery's still coming. They're going to discover me this year. This is the year they discover me because I'm doing so much stuff.
I want to talk to you about that. What does Michael being discovered look like? What does that look like?
Some Steve Harvey money.
Okay.
You know, I need that hundred million.
Right,
let me get the hundred million.
Let
but if I get $100 million, you know what I'm gonna do?
What you
I'm gonna quit.
You gonna
I'm
quit?
Because I'm going shopping.
You're gonna
meet me over the mall. I'll be somewhere in Paris.
My God. Well, listen, we will be right back with Michael when we return. He has so many projects that he's working on. We want to hear all about it. Stay tuned.
Gonna go shopping.
We are back with funny man Michael Collier.
And we're black.
Yes, very much so.
Yes,
we are. And we're both.
Yes.
Absolutely. Many people don't know that you were one of the voices behind Princess and the Frog. What character did you play?
So I was Buford. I was I was the cook. I was the chef on the scene when she came in talking about she's going to get her own restaurant. I said, yeah, and I'm going to win a Kentucky Derby and start galloping around.
Oh, nice.
It was just a magical thing to do a Disney cartoon. That was awesome.
I can imagine. Talk to us about the impact of the play, seeing all the big names that came out to support you. I'm sure that was a highlight for you in your career.
It's a highlight of my whole life, you to be able to tell my story and from where I've come to now, and because I love who I am, the person I look at in the mirror, because of my mother and the influence of God. And so when I did this play, everybody came. Angela Bassett came. She loved it. Robert Townsend said it changed his life. Lou Gossett said it blew his socks off. Jennifer Lewis made everybody stand up.
Yes.
Then we got to take it to the National Black Theater Festival, where they said it was the best play there. So now we're about to book it for a 100-city tour. Mm. And we shot it 4 weeks ago for Netflix.
Come on, now, fist pump.
And I know people ask me, am I boycotting Netflix? No, I ain't boycotting nothing but poverty.
Okay.
That's it. That's all.
They wrote a check.
That's right.
Congratulations on that.
I would be remiss if I didn't ask you, where did the inspiration come from to even create the play? I just have to ask.
Well, you know, I've been wanting to do my story, you know, and then I realized my story is not a story unless it's about my mother's influence.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and so we started writing, playing around with it, and then I started thinking more about my mother, so I started researching my family and found out things about my family, my mom, that I didn't even know, and it made me expand more as a human being.
Ooh,
it is the greatest thing that's happened to me in all of performance, is to be able to do that show live, and I'm channeling my father, and I play 17 characters. Characters and I get to go through my addiction and all of that in this play. I get to react it all. So
I tell you, it takes a man of courage and great talent, which you have both.
God bless you.
And we are happy to have you.
Yay.
Yeah, we're going
to
talk about
I'm happy to be had.
Later, though. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
All right, well, listen here. What was up next, we will have more with Michael.
More of me.
Yes, we
more
will.
Of me.
But right now, the conversations continue on SisterCircleTV.com. Don't go away.